Alleluia, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. Well, welcome to our worship service from St. Mary's Rushden on this, the second Sunday of Easter. Although I'm recording before any official announcement has been made by the government, I have a feeling that this lockdown we're in is going to be with us for some time to come. We're all having to devise new routines for ourselves, new ways of getting our food and other necessities, new ways of getting exercise, new ways, some of us at least, of working at home. Others of us may be having to rely on others to get us our food or to help us with things. Now, some of you may be well settled into your new routine. You've got it all worked out. Others of you, perhaps more like me, are still finding your way. It's been good to hear about all the different ways in which together, collectively, although we're physically separated, as we've been acting as a church, being church for those around us, we've been keeping in touch with friends, neighbors, and with one another, over the phone, emails, other forms of social media. We've been helping people by doing their shopping or getting them other necessities. We've been trying to keep in contact, trying to keep people from being isolated. It's been good as well to see that although the food boxes had to be moved from the church to the rectory front door, people are still coming to make their contributions. And at least once a week, Sue or I take the box down to the food bank. Those in our community who are facing hardship need that support now more than ever before. So thank you for your continued generosity. Well, whichever way you voted in December's general election, I'm sure that together with me, you're glad to see our Prime Minister out of hospital and on the mend. And of course, we continue to pray not just for him, but for the entire government, those in the NHS, those working in care homes, those managing businesses, large and small, as they make important yet very difficult decisions in the days and weeks ahead, decisions which will affect all of us in this country and beyond. Finally, I want to wish happy birthday to all those of you who either have celebrated a birthday already this month or will celebrate a birthday in the days to come in this month. In particular, I'd like to say happy birthday to our curate, Phil, who celebrates his birthday today. Phil, many happy returns of the day.
Surprising, I can feel. hallelujah. Your love makes me sing, hallelujah. 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 Your love makes me sing, hallelujah. 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 Your love makes me sing.
Now let's take a moment to remember those times during the past week when we failed to love either God or neighbor in thought, word, or deed, coming to our Heavenly Father in honesty, humility, and trusting faith in His desire both to forgive and to renew. Let's pray together the words on the screen. Father God, forgive us when we fail to trust you, and particularly when we fail in our love for others. Have mercy on us. Bring us back to faith in your Son, our risen Savior, and love for our neighbors. Help us to live and work for your kingdom through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. May the God of love bring us back to himself, forgive us our sins, and assure us of his eternal love in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
See that. And the world will see that. of different parables that Jesus told his disciples and his followers. So not only are you going to have a fantastic story, a fantastic parable every week, you're also going to get an activity and a little challenge. Now each week we're going to hide a little letter and give you clues for the letter in the stories. Now you have to listen very carefully to try and find out what that letter is. And each week there'll be a different letter, and at the end of the 6 weeks you will have lots of letters to unscramble to try and find out the word. You have to listen each week so you don't miss one. So today we have a parable for you, but before I start I better take off my purple dressing gown. Don't you? I think it's a high time I took that off. I've got some exciting things to show you as well before we get going. I couldn't help but I had to show you my favourite purple stapler. I've been busy doing some stapling this morning. I like the ping noise it makes. I like that noise. I've also got a few Easter eggs left over. I've got a pink one and a purple one. They're pretty, aren't they? I love pretty things, pretty Easter eggs. But I'm getting a little bit distracted. So let's carry on with our parable. Now today's parable is of the mustard seed. Jesus told a story to the people who were following him. He said that faith was like a mustard seed. Now a mustard seed is pretty small. It's smaller than a potato. It's smaller even than a pea. Can you see the pea? A mustard seed is pretty tiny. I don't know whether you'll be able to see that. Oh, I dropped it. Let's try again. Oh. Well, I have a whole jar of them because they're going to keep pinging off. All those tiny, tiny mustard seeds. Jesus said that if you put the seed in the soil, it would grow into the biggest plant of all, a tree. Pretty amazing, right? What Jesus means is that even though his group of followers started off very small, it was a very small group of people who had faith in God and in heaven, it grew and grew and grew until millions of people right now today share that same faith in God and in the kingdom of heaven. In a little while, we're going to hear another story of Jesus and his followers about how amazing faith is, even if you can't even see or hear God. Now, I have a little activity for you as well today. So we are going to set you the challenge of creating food parcels. Now, you can either do this by, excuse my drawing, drawing yourself a little basket with all the different foods which you might think would be essential for somebody, a food parcel, things that people might need. Or even if you wanted to, but you have to ask permission from an adult first, you can get together some food out of your cupboards and create a parcel of food. Pretty cool, huh? But make sure you ask permission. The amazing thing about this activity is that just like the parable, you start off with small bits and pieces and you keep adding and you keep adding and it grows into something wonderful. And what you can do is you can share the food parcel that you've created with everybody on Facebook, or you can take one if you've made a real food parcel out of bits and pieces out of your cupboard after asking for permission. You can take them down to the food bank that's on the rectory steps and you can pop it in there for somebody who needs it. It'll be a wonderful surprise. Now, it would really help somebody in need. Did you guess what our letter was today? Did you need any more clues? That's right, it was the letter P. So you need to remember that for next time. And when we have our parable next week, you need to listen carefully for what the letter would be. See you later.
Hi everyone, today's reading is from John 20, verse 19 to the end. On the evening of the first day of the week, when the disciples were together, with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his sides. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father sent me, I am sending you." And with that, he breathed on them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone their sins are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." Now, Thomas, also known as Didymus, was one of the 12, and was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told them, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands, and put my fingers where the nails were, and put my hands into his sides, I will not believe." A week later, the disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them, and said to them, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your fingers here." Then he said to Thomas, "Reach out your hands and put them in my sides. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord, my God." Then Jesus said to him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen yet have believed." Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of the disciples, which is not recorded in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name.
Hi everyone. Last week on Easter Sunday, we had the passage before our reading this morning in which only one person, Mary Magdalene, meets Jesus. Jesus had risen from the dead. She had gone there to his tomb early in the morning, saw that it was empty, and ran to tell Peter and John. And they ran to the tomb to see, and also found it empty. Later, Mary went back to the tomb, and she encounters two angels. Then she encounters Jesus. But she doesn't immediately recognize him. She thought he was the gardener. Why not, you might ask? She knew Jesus well. Well, perhaps she was in shock. Perhaps it never entered her mind that Jesus could rise from the dead. He just says her name, Mary. She recognizes him at that point and soon goes to tell the disciples that she's seen the Lord Jesus. Now, by the evening, Mary Magdalene is the only one who has seen him. The disciples were afraid. They were afraid of the Jewish leaders. They were so afraid that they might be arrested and even possibly be killed, like Jesus. I expect they didn't know whether to believe her or not. It tells us here in John's Gospel that the disciples were gathered in a house with the doors locked. They were so afraid. Of course, of the 12 disciples, two of them were not there. Judas had betrayed Jesus, so he wasn't there, and Thomas wasn't there. Then Jesus came and stood among them, and it tells us, he says to them, "Peace be with you." They were filled with joy when they saw the Lord. Mary was right. Jesus was alive. Now, there are two stars in the passage today, two important characters. Obviously, Jesus, but also Thomas. You know, Thomas has traditionally had a bad press. For centuries, he's been called Doubting Thomas, and people who doubted were called Doubting Thomases. Now, if you're a young person listening, do you still call people Doubting Thomases today? I used to when I was a boy. When I was about 10, I used to be the leader of a little gang of children who lived close to me here in Rushden in Rose Avenue. They were all about 7, 8 or 9. I was the eldest. It was a club. I even made them membership cards. Now, I have to say, things were different in those days. We were allowed to do things that children are not allowed to do today. But I used to take them on little adventures out into the countryside. We would take sandwiches and orange squash for our lunch. We would walk miles. Sometimes, as we walked, one of my little companions would say, "We're lost," as if I didn't know where we were. And I would reply, "You doubting Thomas." Now, where did I get that from? Perhaps school? Perhaps church? I don't know. I wonder, children, do you call people doubting Thomases today? Perhaps not. I don't know. The gospel tells us that Thomas wasn't there the first time Jesus appeared to the disciples. It doesn't say where he was, but the others later told him that they'd seen Jesus. And he said, "I won't believe unless I see the nail marks on Jesus' body and touch them and put my hand in the hole in his side. I don't believe you," he said. Thomas wanted evidence. He was no fool. He thought the others might be imagining stuff. "But I want real proof," he said. Now, Jesus could have said, "If Thomas won't believe, that's up to him." Jesus could have said, "I don't care whether Thomas believes or not." But you see, Jesus did care. So 1 week later, the disciples were gathered together again in the house with the doors locked. And this time Thomas was with them. And Jesus comes and stands among them and says again to them, "Peace be with you." He says this on both occasions because wouldn't you be a bit afraid if you saw someone who was dead alive again? I would be. Now Jesus gets Thomas to feel the nail marks and put his hand in the hole in Jesus' side. You see, Jesus wasn't a ghost. He had a real body. They weren't imagining this. It was real. And the reason they knew it was real was because Thomas wanted evidence and Jesus gave it to him. Now, in response, Thomas says to Jesus, "My Lord and my God." This is the first time in the New Testament that anyone calls Jesus God. So Thomas is not doubting Thomas, but believing Thomas. He is the first to believe that Jesus is God. Now, there are things here in this passage that might suggest that Jesus' body was somehow different. It still had the terrible marks of the crucifixion, but Mary didn't immediately recognise him at the tomb on that first Easter morning. And I don't know if you notice, when Jesus appeared to the disciples on both occasions, the doors were locked before he arrived. How did he get in? Now, we're not told how he did it, how he got into a securely locked house to meet with the disciples. But we're talking about a supernatural God here. If you believe what the gospel says about Jesus at the beginning of John's gospel, I'm going to read from John chapter 1, where John calls Jesus the Word. He says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made." That's John chapter 1, verses 1 to 3. What he's saying is that before Jesus was born, he was with God. He was with God the Father. And he, Jesus, was also God. Remember, Jesus said, "I and the Father are one." Now, it also says in John chapter 1 that through the Word, Jesus, all things were made. The earth, the universe, everything. If he had that sort of power, surely he's capable of anything. And after his resurrection, he starts to behave in ways different to human beings. One of them is being able to just appear among the disciples in a locked house. We need to remember, though, that Jesus was not a ghost. He had a real body that Thomas touched. And in the next chapter, Jesus' real body was able to cook breakfast with real hands for the disciples on the shore of the Sea of Galilee. Later, of course, Jesus ascended to his Father in heaven and later sent the Holy Spirit into the world to live in us who believe. Now, people have seen visions of Jesus, but we can't have exactly the same experience as Thomas. Jesus can't come into the lives of each of the billions of people who live in the world today to let them see and feel his body. That's why Jesus says to Thomas, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." He's talking about us and everyone since who has believed in Jesus and his resurrection. John goes on to say at the end of our reading that the things written about Jesus in the gospel are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. And life here means eternal life, life after death with God forever. Now, lots of people doubt the Christian message, and in a way, it's not wrong to doubt if that doubt leads you to try your hardest to find out whether what the Bible says is true or not. Someone listening today may be in that position. Now, I could recommend lots of books and stuff for you to read, but I'm just going to recommend one. It's called The Case for Christ by Lee Strobel. Lee Strobel was an American journalist. He was an atheist, and his wife was taken to church by a friend, and she became a Christian, which made him very angry. He decided to investigate Christianity with all of his journalist skills. He was determined to prove it wrong, that Jesus did not rise from the dead. The story was made into a film, also called The Case for Christ. If you can get it, it's absolutely brilliant, because Lee finds the evidence for the resurrection so compelling that he believes in Jesus, and it totally changes his life. I believe the evidence for Jesus' resurrection with all my heart. And in this time when death is very evident around us, I encourage you to believe in the one who has defeated death and will be pleased to give you life after death if you trust in him. Let's pray together, shall we? Heavenly Father, we ask that in this time in which we hear about people dying, a time of anxiety for many, we pray, Lord, that you will help us to trust you, the one who has defeated death, the one who reigns supreme in the universe. Lord, we ask that you will help us to trust you and to believe in you, that we may have that eternal life with you forever. We pray to you, Lord, in Jesus Christ's name. Amen.
Well, we're still in the Easter season, as our reading and Glenn's address reminded us. So in our affirmation of faith, we remind ourselves of the good news, the great joy of the risen Christ. We find the words of our affirmation on the screen. Christ died for our sins in accordance with the scriptures. He was buried. He was raised to life on the third day in accordance with the scriptures. Afterwards, he appeared to his followers and to all the apostles. This we have received, and this we believe. Amen.
Thank you.
for today. Risen Christ, for whom no door is locked and no entrance barred, open the doors of our hearts that we may seek the good of others and walk the joyful road of sacrifice and peace to the praise of God the Father. Amen. Father God, we turn our hearts to you in this time of fear and unrest, and we seek your peace and mercy. We pray for our world and every nation as we face the COVID-19 virus. We remember, Lord, that even in these times of unrest, we have faith and trust in you. Lord, we pray for all of those who work tirelessly to keep our day-to-day lives on track. Our nation's leaders, our governments, our medical staff and carers, our retailers, hauliers and farmers, to all the key workers who provide essential care and produce to us in this time of uncertainty. We thank you, Lord, for each of them, and that you continue to guide them with your wisdom and strength. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we pray for all who are unwell and suffering at this time, for those who are suffering with the virus, for those who are lonely, afraid, struggling with addiction or poor mental health. We take a few moments to hold up all of those who are known to us personally. We pray for all of those who have lost loved ones at this time, especially holding up in our prayers the recently bereaved friends and family of Clifford Jeffrey and Anthony Lawrenson. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we pray for our own families and ourselves. In this time of uncertainty and worry, we turn to you, Lord, in faith. We ask that you remind us that even though we cannot see or touch you, that your presence, wisdom, strength and peace is known so well to us in our faith, and that our faith would overflow in us past the boundaries of this lockdown to the others around us in our community, so that your grace and mercy is known to those who do not know you yet, and your kingdom will continue to grow. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Gathering all of our prayers and praises into one, as our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Which the grave.
So we close our worship this morning as I ask you to join together with me in the words of the grace, which we say with, to, and for one another, wherever we may be. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen.